Blackstone Audio presents Reducing Gun Violence in America, Informing Policy with Evidence and Analysis, edited by Daniel W. Webster, SCD, MPH, and John S. Vernick, JD, MPH. This book is read by Traber Burns. To victims of gun violence and to those who work daily to reduce it. Foreword. On December 14, 2012, a deranged young man pulled into the parking lot of the Sandy Hook Elementary School in Newtown, Connecticut, and then shot his way into the building with a high-capacity semi-automatic rifle. The slaughter of 6 adults and 20 children really broke the country's heart, and for many Americans, this is the straw that has broken the camel's back. Since the Sandy Hook massacre, more than 100 mayors from across the country have joined the bipartisan coalition Mayors Against Illegal Guns. The total number of mayors involved is now more than 800. As of January 14, 2013, roughly 1 million Americans have signed on to the coalition's I Demand a Plan campaign against gun violence. Vice President Joe Biden will announce his recommendations for action to President Barack Obama this week. The vice president knows that as horrific as Sandy Hook has been, as have all the other seemingly endless episodes of mass violence, we experience that level of carnage, or worse, every single day across our country. Because every day of the year, an average of 33 Americans are murdered with guns. Here's another way to think about what that means. On January 21st, 2013, President Obama took the oath of office for his second term. Unless we take action, during those 4 years, some 48,000 Americans will be killed with guns, nearly twice as many people as were killed in combat during the entire Vietnam War. I have made it clear to the Vice President that our bipartisan coalition of mayors is supporting 7 measures, 3 that need legislation, and 4 that require only executive action. We're hopeful that the Vice President and President will support all 7. First and most urgently, we need the President and Congress together to require background checks for all gun sales, including private sales at gun shows and online. These private sales now account for more than 40% of all gun sales nationally, which means that in 2012 alone, there were more than 6 million gun sales that happened with no background checks. Many of those guns are handguns, which are used in about 90% of all firearms murders. Across the United States, more than 80% of gun owners and more than 90% of Americans support requiring background checks for all gun sales. There's really no debate here. It's common sense. We have laws on the books that require a background check when dealers sell guns. It's time for the President and Congress to make that the law of the land for all sales. The 40% to which the law does not apply means the law is basically a sham. Second, Congress should make gun trafficking a federal crime. In New York City, 85% of the weapons that we recover from crime scenes come from out-of-state sources. But federal laws designed to curb illegal sales across borders are incredibly weak. Criminals who traffic in guns get a slap on the wrist. We've made New York the safest big city in the nation, in part by adopting tough gun laws and proactively enforcing them. Every state in the union has citizens killed by guns coming from another state, and every state is powerless to stop the mayhem. Until Congress gets tough on trafficking, guns will continue flowing to our streets from states with much looser gun laws. The third legislative measure that the White House should support is limiting the availability of military-style weapons and of high-capacity magazines with more than 10 rounds. These guns and equipment are not designed for sport or home defense. They are designed to kill large numbers of people quickly. That's the only purpose they have. They belong on the battlefield, in the hands of our brave, professionally trained soldiers, not on the streets of our cities, suburbs, or rural areas, as retired military leaders like Colin Powell and Stanley McChrystal have said. Many of the weapons in this category were previously banned under the federal assault weapons law that expired in 2004. That law was, incidentally, first initiated and passed by Vice President Biden. He is the right person to have been appointed by the president to come up with what we should do next. Regulating assault weapons certainly falls within the bounds of the Second Amendment. So does everything else we're urging. This is not a constitutional question. It's a question of political courage. The U.S. Supreme Court, the entity that defines what the Constitution means, has ruled that reasonable regulations are consistent with the Second Amendment. When the gun lobby raises concerns over protection of the Second Amendment, it is nothing but a red herring. And it's time for Second Amendment defenders in Congress to call them on it. The three measures that I've discussed, requiring background checks for all gun sales, making gun trafficking a federal crime, and limiting military-style assault weapons and high-capacity magazines, will require leadership from both the President and members of Congress. But there are other steps President Obama can take without congressional approval, anytime he chooses, with a stroke of a pen. Vice President Biden understands this, and we hope his recommendations will include at least these next four steps that we've urged him to take. In the first of these four steps, the president can order all federal agencies to submit their relevant data to the National Gun Background Check Database. Every missing record is a potential murder in the making. If the data aren't in the database, those people that use the database don't get what they need, allowing gun sales to go ahead in cases where we all agree and federal law says they shouldn't. Second, the president can direct the Justice Department to make a priority of prosecuting convicted criminals who provide false personal information during gun purchase background checks. Yes, even criminals buy from dealers, knowing there's going to be a background check, except that they lie when they do so. As a matter of fact, during 2010, there were more than 76,000 cases referred by the FBI to the Justice Department. Do you know how many were prosecuted out of 76,000 in 2010, the last year for which we have data? 44. Not 44,000, but 44 out of 76,000. This is a joke. It's a sad joke, and it's a lethal joke. These are felony cases involving criminals trying to buy guns, and yet our federal government is prosecuting less than 0.1% of them. It is shameful, and it has to end.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.